such what a joy it is to invite you into the Lord's presence this evening. Even as we get into a time of worship, I just want to begin by reading two verses from Psalm 106. This is what it says: Praise the Lord, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good, His love endures forever. Who can proclaim the mighty acts of the Lord or fully declare His praise? And I just realized as you read through this entire psalm that God has done so much in our lives. But so often we have forgotten what He has done. We have, rebelled against Him. We have turned a deaf ear to Him. And yet He is faithful. He doesn't change. And I want us to just focus today, even as we worship together, that we will keep our eyes on what God has done for us. All the things, the wonders, the miracles, the signs, things we have even missed, that we would ask Him to bring it back to mind so that we don't get discouraged just because of what He's not doing now for us, but we remember on all that He has done and that we will hold on. That is the source of our faith, that this is a God who keeps His word. This is a God who saves us. This is a God who keeps to His word at all costs. No matter how unfaithful we are, He is faithful to His promises. And so if we could turn our focus, so often we get distracted by all that is not happening and we forget all that He has done. And if we could come from that position of gratitude, I think it will change our perspective completely. So I just want to encourage you that as we worship Him for who He is. We worship Him for what He has done and what He continues to do. Let's worship Him together.
What a joy, what a privilege it is for us to worship Him, to come together and see how beautiful it is that we are connected remotely. But the beauty is that the Holy Spirit is so evident while we are recording, even while you listen to this. And can we take some time to worship this God who is the Trinity, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And each of them in their unique ways minister to us even today. Can we worship Him? Can we praise and lift His name high above every other?
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, who would have thought that a rescue the souls of man. Oh, You rescue the souls of man. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace. Our hearts always hunger. Always hungry. Remains one thing.
up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Wherever you are, and there's this one reminder He wants to give you. He still loves you. He still loves you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. I don't know, however dead the situations look like, as we choose to worship Him, as we choose to lay everything before Him and fall prostrate and tell, Lord, You deserve all the glory. You deserve all the honor, Lord Father. Humble myself. Lord, would You help me? Would You help me to humble myself, Lord Father? Lord, if there's any bit of pride in us, Lord Jesus, Lord, we pray that You would consume it by Your fire, Lord Father. Let Your Holy Spirit cleanse us one more time. Lord, every form of pride, every form of evil desires of our heart, Lord, we pray that You would come in, Lord Father. Lord, the breakthroughs that we've been praying for, those moments, those desires that You've put in our heart, which is for a very long time that we have not seen the fruits of it, Lord Father. Lord, we lay it all at Your feet, Lord Jesus. May Your Holy Spirit sweep across every living room, every place from where this is being listened, Lord Father. Lord, we pray, Lord Jesus, that You would consume us, Lord Father. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, we fall down. We lay down before You, Lord Father. You're almighty. You're sovereign, Lord God. You're sorry for so many things, Lord Jesus, that for which we have taken control of our own self, Lord Father. We are sorry. Lord, sometimes, Lord Father, we just want to do it with our own talents and different other things, Lord Father. With the exposure, with the experience that You've given us, Lord Father, we take things in our hand. Lord, today we pray, Lord Jesus, that You would help us to leave it all at Your feet, Lord Jesus. Fall down before You, Lord, and may You lead us, Lord Jesus. We lay all our crowns and all our accolades and all that we hold close and dear, Lord Jesus, we lay it at Your feet, Lord God. Oh Jesus.
We fall down. We lay our crowns at the feet of Jesus. The greatness of Your mercy and love at the feet of Jesus. We cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy, holy, holy is the Lamb.
Jesus.
We fall. Holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy, holy.
holiness. May it cover each and every one of us, Lord, who's listening, who's playing here, who, every one of us, Lord Jesus. May you cover us with your holiness, Lord Jesus. May we be always be sensitive to the work of the Holy Spirit. Jesus, continue to counsel us, Lord Father. Comfort us, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord, for your move in this place. Thank you, Lord. We allow you to move, Lord Jesus. Take complete control, Lord. Hallowed be your name, Lord Jesus. May your kingdom come. In Jesus' name, we ask and we pray.
Lord, we just praise you and we thank you for all that you are doing. We thank you, Father, for all the things you have done for us in the past. The very fact that we sit before you, that we stand before you, is a gift from above, Lord. And we are so thankful for your grace, your mercy over our lives. And even now, God, we just bring the nations of the world to you. We thank you that, Lord, we are just but a speck in your eyes. And yet, oh Father, you are so mindful of us. And we pray, God, that as we worship you, as we come before you, that, Lord, our eyes will be lifted up to your throne. We pray, Lord, for the Middle East. We pray for peace. Lord, I pray for Ukraine and Russia for peace. I pray for the land of Manipur in our country, Lord, for peace to prevail. We pray, Lord, that your will be done for these people. We believe your will is justice and righteousness and peace. And we speak it over these nations right now. We pray for the people who are suffering in these places, who have been displaced, Lord, who have been relocated by force. We just pray in Jesus' name that you would bring them back to their homes. That, Lord, where homes and buildings have been decimated, that, God, you will make a way, Lord, for them to have safety once more. That, Lord, your promise which says, my people will dwell in peaceful habitations. I pray that over these people. I pray for the children who have been orphaned by the hundreds. God, I pray that they will experience once more the love of mothers and fathers, God. We pray that the adoptions around the world would increase. We pray, oh Father, that families and churches would embrace these children who have lost families. Father, I pray, Lord, at this time for our country, we bless this land. We pray for all that you are doing and continuing to do. We thank you that, Lord, your will prevails. We pray, God, that you would bless every leader in our country. Bless every minister, oh Father, that they would lead with a love, a genuine concern and empathy for the people that they lead, oh Father. We pray for righteousness and justice to flow from the north to the south, from the west to the east. We pray that every people group who are seen and loved by you, Lord, that their needs would be seen and heard by leaders. Father, we pray very specially for the climatic conditions of our country. We pray for areas that are stricken with excessive rain. We pray for the places where there is no rain. We pray for farmers. We pray, Lord, for those who run small street side businesses. We pray no one would suffer. We pray, Lord, that you would meet the need of big and small. We pray, God, that you will be the great leveler who will bring everyone into one place of unity, of love, of community. Lord, that you will bring about great peace in our land, O Father. Father, I pray right now for those who are sitting in this service right now. Father, I pray, we don't know what their needs may be, but you do. I pray for everyone who's struggling with a physical ailment, for healing in Jesus' name, be it through medication, be it through, Lord, their faith in you. I pray that, God, you will do something powerful. Father, I pray at this time for those who are displaced in their heart, in their mind, if they are disturbed. Father, I pray that your peace that passes all understanding will wrap around them, will hold them upright. I pray for those who are on the verge of giving up on you, Lord, who are on the verge of sliding back into old patterns, old lifestyles, that their heart and mind will be refocused on you, Father God. I pray, Lord, for those who are in a season of grief, those who are mourning, Lord, all that they have lost. I pray that, Lord, you would see them, you would hear them, you would answer them, that you would wipe every tear, Lord, that you will bring restoration, you would bring recompense, Lord. I pray that, Lord, even as we get into this time of hearing your word, that, God, your word would come through so powerfully, that, Lord, it will do the work it has to do in our lives. Prepare our hearts, Lord, to receive your word. Make our hearts good soil in which the word will be deposited deeply. I pray, Father, even as it's a season of harvest, I pray for those who are going through a hard time, where there is a shaking, where there is a beating, oh Father, in the spiritual realm. I just pray for endurance to push through and come out stronger than ever before. We thank you, we love you, we glorify you, we lift ourselves up to you, asking that you will touch us, you will meet us at the point of our need. In Jesus' name I pray, amen, amen. Even as we get into God's Word, a few announcements. We have Sisterhood in Person happening this Saturday. It's at a new time. So if you are in the city, in the vicinity of Omar, we would love to have you join us. Get in touch with us. We would love to connect with you and invite you over for this. We have our youth service happening every Sunday at 7:30 a.m. It's an enjoyable time. We first fellowship over breakfast, and then we meet together to hear God's Word, to have a time of discussion and prayer. So if you are someone, a young adult, young working adult, we would invite you for this. If you are someone who says, I can't make it in person, but I'd love to be part of your men's Bible study, we have that every Wednesday night. It happens on Zoom. So even if you're in another city, you want to be part of this, reach out to us. We'll send you the link. We have our ladies' prayer every Tuesday morning. It's an amazing time, 10:30 to 12, where we just intercede for the needs of the world, the needs of the land, and also for each other. And it's been a very encouraging, empowering time. And we would love for you, if you're a woman who says, you know, I just want company to pray. I want to pray with others. I want to learn how to pray. This is an amazing time. Every Friday evening from 10 to 11, we have a very precious time of just worshiping God, of lingering in His presence. It's called the Open Heavens Night Prayer. So if you are someone who gets off work around that time, or you're heading into a night shift and you have a little bit of free time, please drop by. It's a very powerful time. We have seen God move in people's lives. We are watching God unfold things for each of us. We would love for you to be part of it. So even as we get into God's Word, we are beginning, we have begun a new series. It's about the kingdom of God. We call it the Kingdom Life. We would love for you to just sit back, relax, take notes, because we believe God is going to do something beautiful. As we get into God's Word, can we just prepare ourselves, quieten down everything, maybe mute your phone, settle your little kids down, and let's hear God's Word together.
The life that Jesus lived when on earth looked easy, but needed sacrifice and a dying to self. Daily, it was a distinctly different life from what we know, because it put God first and others next. It required internalizing His word so that it just permeated through. It expected the impossible to happen anytime. Today, we can live that life with God in us and with us through His Spirit. This life is hinged on the finished work of Jesus on that cross. We now have access to His healing, restoration, power, and authority. Will you come join us as we learn to live the Kingdom Life?
Hi, church. Even as we continue meditating on God's word, we go into the second part of the series called The Kingdom Life. Even last week, as we saw The Kingdom Life, we see from the book of Mark, as we emphasize and see from the life of Jesus, we see how Jesus lived right here on this earth and how He lived that kingdom life, and what can we also take from His teachings, take from His life, and live that out. Last week, we saw a couple of things which are very important, which I just wanted to go through some of those points because I believe they matter. The first thing we saw is our motives matter if you want to do good. The second thing we saw is surrender matters if you want the blessing. Third, we saw as Jesus was feeding the 5,000, breaking matters if you want the breakthrough. And the last is our sensitivity, our spiritual sensitivity matters if we want to know God more. Today, even as we look, continue on to look from Mark, from the book of Mark, I'm going to take this entire passage from Mark chapter 2, when God calls Matthew. In some of the translations, it says Levi, but Matthew is again the tax collector. He's the one who's written the book, the gospel according to Matthew. And he was a tax collector, and Jesus says, come and, you know, follow me. And even as he makes that obedient call on his own life and follows Jesus, that evening he is sitting and they all are dining together, and this incident happens right there. And even as we look at the kingdom life, we see that this kingdom life is not something that we are called to live by our own. We are part of a kingdom. We are part of God's kingdom. And our God is Jesus. And we see that in this entire kingdom, we don't get to just live the way we like. There are guardrails. There are ways in which God's calling us to live because we represent Him. We are walking witnesses of Jesus right here on this earth. And so today, as you and me are reading through the scripture, I want you to look into your own lives. Probably there are areas where we've been ashamed of being part of the kingdom, that we've chosen to live by the standards of the world. But God's saying, no, if you're part of my kingdom, if you call me Lord and Savior of your life, you need to be following me. You need to be living the way I want you to live, doing what I've called you to do, and also hope that I would come through. And one of the beautiful things that we see when Jesus came here to establish his kingdom here on this earth is not one like our earthly kingdoms. He's not like an authoritarian. He's operating out of pure love. He's cleansed us. He's washed us white as snow. He's purchased us. He's redeemed us, wherein we no longer have to strive for our salvation. Rather, we invite him and we live the life that he's called us to live. So let's continue on to read from Mark chapter 2, verses 18 to 22. And this is what it says. Now, John's disciples and the Pharisees were fasting. Some people came and asked Jesus, how is it that John's disciples and the disciples of the Pharisees are fasting, but yours are not? Jesus answered, how can the guests of the bridegroom fast while he is with them? They cannot so long as they have with him, but the time will come when the bridegroom will be taken from them, and on that day they will fast. No one sews a patch of unshrunk cloth on an old garment. Otherwise, the new piece will pull away from the old, making the tear worse. And no one pours new wine into old wineskins, otherwise the wine will burst the skin. Both the wine and the wineskin will be ruined. No, they pour new wine into new wineskins. As we read this, Jesus was talking to a group of Pharisees and the disciples of John the Baptist. And one of the things that we see when we are living and being part of the kingdom is sometimes if we don't allow ourselves to live in the newness that Jesus wants us to live. What is the newness that Jesus wants? A constant dependency, a constant communication with him. We will be people who are questioning everything. We see here, they come and they question, they say, why are you not fasting? And probably in the Jewish culture at that time was probably a season of fast. But Jesus goes on to say they have the bridegroom with them and it's a time of celebration. During a wedding time, during weddings usually take a week-long celebration. And no one is fasting during that week-long celebration. They're in fact joyous. They're celebrating. They are not mourning or they're not, in repentance mode and sitting quietly covered in sackcloth. No. There is a time for that. And here Jesus reiterates them to tell them, you need to know what time you're in. He says, there will be a time when they will fast. There will be a time when they will pray. There will be a time, but this is a time for celebration because the bridegroom is with them. One of the beautiful things we see as followers of Jesus is we need to be aware of which season we are in. You know, one of the things that we see is the disciples just followed Jesus. And so they did whatever Jesus told them to do. They were in the company of Jesus, but the others didn't know who this Jesus was. They didn't spend time with him. They didn't acknowledge who Jesus was. And so oftentimes they looked through these critical eyes saying that they're not fulfilling something. They're not observing this. They're not doing that. But Jesus came to set his kingdom here on this earth. And it got me wondering, are we sometimes like that? Where we have been so caught up in doing the right thing that our hearts are not there in the right place. That we have been so caught up in doing the right thing that our minds have wandered, our hearts are affected with other things that concern the world rather than concern God. Because if we are having this dichotomy within ourselves where we do things so that it looks pleasing to the world that we are Christ followers, yet our hearts are far away, there is a problem with that. Or probably our encounter with Jesus just at one time. And eventually we've built these systems, these habits, these ways of saying things and doing things that we forget that we need to live in the new anointing. You know, as I'm going to pick up specifically on the passage of new wine and new wineskins, because I believe that is the kingdom life. We are not called to be old wine with old wineskins. He's saying, I want to be new wine with new wineskins. You know, the world celebrates when things are aged. It's probably sold much. It probably tastes better. They have reasons as to what it looks like. But God's saying, no, I don't want my children. I don't want people who follow me, who are part of my kingdom, to be content with the old anointing. And we see a key element in this is the Holy Spirit, who Jesus said, I'm leaving back so that he will be there with you to take you on this journey. We need to be aware of our time. We read in 1 Chronicles chapter 12, verse 32. This is a time when David was establishing and gathering people around, even as Saul was just on a wild goose chase to hunt down David. There was an entire tribe, the sons of Issachar, it says, they knew and understood the times and they joined David. We need to know when seasons are shifting. We need to know, we need to be aware, and that happens when we are spiritually connected to God's word. That's what I love our church. I love every time when the church gathers across the world, every Sunday, every weekend when they gather to worship God and hear God's word. It's a confirmation of what you've been reading through the week. That has to be that. You can't go there thinking this will just be my word. No, it is a confirmation. Everything will culminate. The Holy Spirit will beautifully integrate everything to what we are reading and confirming at that season, at that point, at that week. And so today I want to ask you, can we be people of discernment? Jesus was saying, if you would know your time, he was telling that to the Pharisees and to John the Baptist disciples, you would be discerning of what's happening right now. What was happening? The Messiah was seated right there. The Messiah was seated. He says he came to seek and save those which are lost. And he was sitting right there with the tax collectors. And he was seeking and doing conversations with them. He was discerning. He was at that moment. The disciples were with Jesus. And so today, as we follow this kingdom life here on this earth, one of the key qualities we need to have is discernment. In fact, I'm just piggybacking off what we heard last week as she concluded, discernment is the baseline. We need to discern. When we discern is when we will know which season we are in. It's in discerning, we'll know whether we are operating out of our old wine or have we allowed God to work in and through us that we can operate out of the new wine. Why were they blinded? They were blinded by tradition, appearances, and status. And Jesus wants to deal with that in our own lives. One of the beautiful things about the kingdom life is we always will unlearn and then we'd learn. We don't come here. It's not like we get educated like how we do in our schools and our universities and then we go into work. Here in this school of the kingdom of life, we always unlearn and learn. Because there's always this component that gets attached to us because of our very own sinful nature. And Jesus is saying, I want to unlearn so that you can learn. Your dependency has to be solely on me. In this kingdom life, there's no one else who you can depend on but me, and that's Jesus. So one of the key kingdom principles with regard to unlearning so we can learn, in fact, it's very so true in my life. I remember in 2013 when God, we had just finished 5 years of working with our church and we had quit and gone to study. And I remember those next 2 years was a lot of unlearning. Lot of unlearning. Unlearning because we were in a bubble and God had to take us out. And in that season, it didn't look like, I mean, we weren't serving, we were present, but there was a lot of unlearning and a lot of learning. And I still remember the 2 years before we started the church in 2016-17, a lot of unlearning. I remember we used to go for our cohort sessions and it was happening in Bangalore. And so every time we left, we had to drive there 6 hours. And even as we were going, we went with a lot of questions. We went with God, why is this? What? How? Why now? Why all that? And when we came back with all those questions answered because God taught us how to unlearn right there and he taught us how to learn right there. So today it comes down to us. And I would encourage you, if you would take time to look into your own lives and say, God, what is it that I have to unlearn? Some things I become so confident about. I don't know about you, but sometimes when we do things 4-5 times, we become so confident of that process. We know this is what the outcome is. But with kingdom life, God's telling, no, your dependency should be on me. So you will trust me with the outcome. So there are three things I want to highlight even as we look into the scripture. The first thing which I want to do with Jesus in our lives, every season needs a new anointing. Every season needs a new anointing. Yesterday's anointing cannot sustain me for today. Today, a lot of us are dependent on yesterday's anointing. What does that mean? A lot of us have to, when we are doing this Christian walk, we are walking in seasons. There's a season of sowing, there's a season of watering, there's a season of growth, there's a season of pruning, there's a season of harvest, there's a season of rest, there's a season of planting the seeds again. And we see that our lives are in seasons. And just imagine if each and every individual, one of us are in a season, then imagine the entire church. Each of us have our own seasons and we need to know what season we are in. Because if we have to operate in the season we are in today, we need today's anointing. We can't rely on yesterday's anointing. Yesterday's anointing was for yesterday. Today's anointing is for today. And that's why we have to seek God every day. That's why we go back to His word saying, God, I need your grace today. God, I need your help today. God, I need your word for today. I need to seek Jesus every season and operate out of that anointing I receive for that day. A lot of us are trying to operate an entire new season with an old anointing. We can get away. We can showcase we've got it. But Jesus knows. You know, last week we were just looking in the youth, we were looking and it reminded me our intentions matter a lot. Our heart intentions matter a lot because we can justify ourselves with our actions, but our motives really matter. And it says here that if we do not operate the new season with the new anointing and if you're operating out of the old anointing, it leaves us empty. How many of you have seen that, that you've just clinging on to a promise that was given for a previous season? And it's left you empty. Some of you seem to be operating out of that old anointing, but it's kept you in the same position. You don't see any movement. For a lot of us, when we are in that old anointing and we don't have a fresh revelation, we don't have plans for the next. We seem to have so many plans in our mind, but we are not able to convert it into paper. Some of us, for those of us that are stuck in paper, we're not able to see it in reality. We need a fresh anointing. We need a fresh anointing from Him. We feel left alone while others are going forward. Jesus draws a parallel to new wine and new wineskin. And the reason is these new wine that's been processed, that's been made, is stored and is used then and there. It's used for that season. They don't just keep it and store it and, you know, keep it for years end. No, they use it for that season right ahead. It was a staple thing. So which Jesus is coming to say, you all should desire new wine. And even as we look into that, I wanted to take a couple of a portion from Isaiah. And it shows a parallel as to what happens when we settle with the old anointing, when we settle with the old wine, when we settle thinking, you know what, that's enough. Isaiah chapter 5 verses 1 to 7, and this is what it says. Now I will sing for the one I love a song about his vineyard. My beloved had a vineyard on a rich and fertile hill. He plowed the land, cleared its stones, and planted it with the best wines. In the middle, he built a watchtower and carved a wine press in the nearby rocks. Then he waited for a harvest of sweet grapes. The grapes that grew were bitter. Now, people of Jerusalem and Judah, you judge between me and my vineyard. What more could I have done for my vineyard that I have not already done? When I expected sweet grapes, why did my vineyard give me bitter grapes? Now, let me tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will tear down its hedges and let it be destroyed. I will break down its walls and let the animals trample it. I will make it a wild place where the vines are not pruned and the ground is not hoed. A place of overgrown with briars and thorns. I will command the clouds to drop no rain on it. The nation of Israel is a vineyard of the Lord of heaven's armies. The people of Judah are his pleasant gardens. He expected a crop of justice, but instead he found oppression. He expected to find righteousness, but instead he heard cries of violence. What is inside matters. what is inside matters. Today we are all about appearances. The reason why we desire for a new anointing is because we want to be changed inside out. The reason why we desire for a new anointing is that we are saying, God, fill me in first before I pour it out. Lord, fill me in first. Lord, I don't want to operate out of the old anointing. The old anointing will be bitter. The old anointing will bring about prejudice. The old anointing will bring about judgment. The old anointing will make me strive. And one of the things we see here, Isaiah is prophesying, and right after this, God sends the Assyrians to them, and you know, they go into captivity. What we see happen is when we stop seeking God's anointing in the everyday, when we settle for the old anointing, whatever good turns to bad. Yes, the people enjoyed freedom. The old anointing, probably they enjoyed that freedom. But soon the freedom later became, they started oppressing those who were underneath them. The riches got to them and then they started becoming proud. They suddenly thought they had more than enough and they didn't need a God. So you see, sometimes our old anointing can be the very chokehold for us to receive God's blessing today. And I would ask if we can all go back to that posture of the altar where we say, God, we are sorry. My heart was not in the right place. My heart was proud. In fact, when I read from the message, this is what it says in verse 7. It says, do you get it? The vineyard of the God of the angel armies is the country of Israel. All the men and women of Judah are the garden he was so proud of. He looked for a crop of justice and saw them murdering each other. He looked for harvest of righteousness and heard only the moans of victims. And so today I want to ask you, church, I want to ask us, are we people who are operating off the old anointing, that we think we are doing God's work and we're living the kingdom life, but yet we've become oppressors. We've become people who are slanderers. We've become people who are gossip. We have become people who are so discontent. God's wanting us to have a heart check. Sin turns good into evil. The old anointing can only guard us and keep us safe for that season. Some of those successes that come out of the old anointing will become the very stones that we stumble and fall in the new season. In our pursuit to show kindness and help, we end up causing more damage because we fail to work on our anointing and rely on our good works. The reading of Isaiah is a reminder that our anointing for a season may be a chokehold for the coming season ahead if we don't seek God. In comparison, Jesus reminded the people that they just don't have to fast and celebrate and do this out of the rhythm of just being in Israel, being an Israelite, and just doing it because everyone is doing it, but rather it has to be a heart dissection, where I go back and say, God, in this season of fast, I truly repent. I'm just not doing it so that we all are called to do it. No, I'm doing it because, God, you are working in through me. When it's a season of celebration, I'm really giving thanks. I'm really celebrating. I'm really in jubilation of what God's done, and I testify about what he's done. You see that anointing is essential if we need Jesus to be in our life so that we can live this kingdom life out. The anointing is what will keep us in check. The anointing is what will guard our very mouth before we even utter it. The anointing is what will enable our discernment levels to be more clear. Our anointing is what will open our spiritual ears and spiritual eyes to see his truth. To see the fruitfulness of the kingdom of God in our own lives, we need to wholly give ourselves to him, not in part. So today there has to be an equation between our inner man and what we do. We can keep doing it all we want, because many of us are people pleasers. Many of us are doing it for the crowd. Many of us are doing it for the audiences. We can do, we can show up, we can be there. But God's saying, I want you entirely, not a part of you, not the physical part of you. In fact, one of the things Jesus came to the world and wanted to break down was the physical act which they got right. He wanted to break that down. He said the physical act and your spiritual act are not matching. And today in the kingdom life, they both have to match. And that's where the anointing comes. And so church, today I want you to come first to realize that you all need the anointing. It's not for the one who's actually on this side of the pulpit. No, it's for each and every one of us. I need the anointing every time I come to speak God's word. Otherwise, I'll be speaking out of my own flesh. I'll be speaking what I think is right. I have to come to a place in God. As I'm speaking this, Lord, you're doing this in my life. And I'm grateful for you. I'm grateful. Even as I share this, I know I'm not worthy. But even as I stand and hear and share it, I'm sharing it because you are working in and through my life. And so, church, I want to ask you today, each of you desire the anointing. Each of you are meant to have your own anointing. And each of you are called to operate in that anointing. That anointing is for this season. This season. So today, if you are a parent and if you have a teenager, ask him, God, I want the anointing of that to parent a teenager. For those of you who are single and who are ready to get married, you've started your work, you've been working, and now parents are starting to look out for you. Ask God, even as I'm looking out for this person in my life who I have to do life with, give me the anointing for that. And suddenly, what happens when the anointing comes? Things that matter the most start becoming, rising up to the surface. Things that don't matter the most all start sinking down. You start keeping your eyes on what God's called you. That's why I love when we seek His anointing for that season, He shows us what to value, what to make the main thing main, and press on. The second thing that we see is with Jesus in our lives, every crushing needs a VAT. Every crushing needs a VAT. You know, even as I'm talking about the new wine skin, I was just reading up upon the entire process of how wine is made and why Jesus brought this as a reference. And one of the beautiful things that you see happen in the culture of Israel is they had these places where they would build so that they can bring all the harvested grapes, put it in there. They would wash their feet and they would jump into it. And this is where it became a community thing. And this is where I think Jesus says that, you know, constantly says that you're not called to do this life alone. You have to do it with people. And so what happens in that process of the crushing of the grapes is people stand and they stamp. And if you see them do that entire process, it's one, they sing songs. It's a time of they make joy out of the work that they're doing. But the entire thing is it's merciless. The grapes don't receive any mercy. And it's a messy affair. And I believe a lot of times when we are giving ourselves to Jesus in this kingdom life, when we submit ourselves, we go through that crushing. We go through that crushing. And the crushing is necessary. A lot of us today are outside trying to figure out a way of how we can become wine without the crushing. But Jesus is saying, no, you need to go through that process of crushing. And what does that crushing involve? God allows us to crush it. For those of us who don't like the messiness, we might just be so soft in our crushing. But Jesus is saying, no, if you need to go through that crushing, you need to do it the right way. You need to do it the right way. In Israel, they stood on the wine press and crushed the grapes. And one of the thing is, the heel is the strongest part of the crushing. In our feet, the heel, where our entire body weight rests on, is where the crushing is the most. And crushing is really necessary. Crushing is nearly necessary. Even as I said earlier, sin, everything, if we operate out of the old anointing, and we don't seek for the new, suddenly the good becomes evil because sin is constantly at work. Just because we've received our anointing doesn't mean we are devoid of sin. It's in our process of being anointed, we are made more aware of our sinful nature. And so what happens in this crushing is that even as we are using our heel to crush, we are crushing our pride. We are crushing our selfishness. We are crushing our self-pity. We are crushing our me-first attitude. We are crushing our understanding of, God, why I'm making it all about myself. God causes us to stand on our heels and crush it. Crush our own grapes. Crush our own ego. Crush our own self so that He will be glorified through that. So that we die to our sin. And even as I was meditating on this, and suddenly the Holy Spirit reminded me, the heel has the power to crush. And a lot of us are hesitating to crush with our heel because we don't want sin to go out completely from our lives. If I take our references back to Genesis chapter 3 verses 15, God comes into the garden and asks Adam and Eve where they are, and they are hiding. And then Eve points out, this is what Satan made me do, and this is what God gives as a punishment to Satan. And where does it say? It says in 3 verse 15, Genesis 3 15, I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers, and he will crush your head and you will strike his heel. The reason why we need the new anointing is because Satan is constantly going to be attacking our heel. He's going to be constantly attacking our heel so that we don't crush sin out of our own systems, so that we don't crush sin out of our own earthly desires that we have. So for those of you who want to crush pornography out, stand by your heel and in Jesus' name, break it. For those of you who want to crush the emotional distress that you're going through, take courage in who Jesus is and stand on your heel and crush every negativity that the enemy is putting. For those of you who want to take a hold of your sexuality, stand on your heels and crush the enemy on the questioning that he's doing over your sexuality. For those of you who are discontent with your marriage bed and are looking elsewhere, I would urge you, believer, take Jesus at his word and stand on your heels and crush sin out of that grapefruit that is causing you discontent and causing you to look elsewhere. He will constantly strike you at this because he doesn't want you to let go of the sinful nature. That's what happens in the crushing. It breaks us. It tears us apart. It messes us up so much that we're saying, God, I'm so sorry. My sinful nature was at play. Romans chapter 16 verses 19 to 20 goes on to say, everyone has heard about your obedience, so I rejoice because of you. But I want you to be wise about what is good and innocent about what is evil. The God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. The grace of our Lord Jesus be with you. I was meditating on this and I was thinking, God, what is it that you want me to be aware of? He's saying here, Paul tells the Roman church as he concludes, he says, everyone has heard about your obedience, so I rejoice, but I want you to be wise so that what is good and innocent, he wants us to be wise about what is good and innocent, about what is evil. In the message, it says, make sure every good thing is a real thing. People's intentions, discernment, all that will have to go through the heel. You will soon see people's true color in their crushing. You will see, that's why people who have not sought after a new anointing in the crushing go missing from church. They go missing from community. They suddenly are within the four walls having a pity party all by themselves. And God is saying, rise up. You need the new anointing in your life. You need to go through the crushing so that you will know and die to your sinful nature. The crushing causes me to reevaluate. The crushing causes me to distinguish between the good and innocent things that I thought were good and innocent, but they actually are evil. They are not causing me to make progress in this new season that God's calling me. It's in the crushing of the grapes that every small bit, everything that's unwanted, the seed, the stem of it, everything starts coming out. Everything is separated. The skin comes out. The pulp comes out. Everything gets, and it's in that that they all go down to the bottleneck where they get filtered out and that gets poured into the vat. When you see the olden days, how they did it, especially in Israel's context, is with every of that wine press next to it, they would have dug up and they would have placed earthen vessels there. And this wine would go in, which is being pressed. They would collect all the sediments away, but they would go right in. And as it goes in, it goes in there and it sits there. And in a couple of weeks, it ferments and it becomes wine. And a lot of us today need a vat for our crushing. You don't need social media to tell people, you know what, I'm going through crushing. You don't need your best friends here to say, you know what, I'm going through a crushing. You need Jesus and you time to go through a crushing. There are a few people who I know who would rather spend their Sunday mornings with Jesus and coffee and breakfast, or Jesus, coffee and brunch. I would challenge you, come to the community of believers, because that's where you'll find encouragement. That's where you'll be able to stand in the gap for someone else who's wanting a breakthrough. If you don't stand for someone else who's wanting a breakthrough, how will someone else be able to stand on your behalf and pray for your breakthrough? That's what community does. The problem is, a lot of us have gone into silos with our WATs. But the beauty that we see in following Jesus is that we bring that crushing, we bring that very fine wine that's come out after all that messiness. We bring it back every day to Jesus, and we allow Him to work in and through us. The reason is why I'm saying we all need a VAT. A lot of us are using someone else's VAT. A lot of us are using our support system. A lot of us are thinking our spouse is our savior. A lot of us are thinking our parents is our savior. A lot of us are using our kids as our VAT. A lot of us are thinking, you know what? My Monday to Friday is my VAT. That's where. No, God is saying you need to take it for yourself. Dig a hole, put it right there, and allow it to ferment. Allow it to work. There'll be seasons where God will say, you know what, just take a step back. Let me work in you. This thing that's caused you to see the messiness and the sin that you've dealt with and everything, allow me to shape you today. Allow me to shape you. And that's where we have the potter who's willing to shape our vat so that we can hold the wine and He can work in and through us. It's in the crushing which brings us to a place of total surrender. And as we give our lives to Him wholly, we realize that we give our identity, our security, and our dependency to Him. Our false sense of identity is crushed. Our false understanding of security is crushed. And that whatever we are leaning and hoping on and the dependency that we have is crushed. And Jesus is saying, I am here to strengthen you. I am here to work in and through you. I remember a season in my life when the crushing happened and everything happened. And I knew that I was not being used of God in the physical. But in the spiritual, God was definitely doing something. God was enabling me to see the kingdom at large. God was starting to deposit certain things. And I realized in that season, if I was more busy in the physical, I would have missed out of everything in the things that He was doing in the spiritual. So for those of you who've been, probably you were busy at one season and now you're holding back. You're seeing God is taking you through this crushing phase. Enjoy the season of VAT. Because in the season of VAT is where He ferments it. In the season of VAT is where He births a lot of things. In the season of VAT where He gives dreams and visions and ideas of what you have to do. It's in the season of VAT He equips you. It's in the season of VAT you draw closer to Him. Because then there will be a season when He'll call you to pour out and it'll be busy. And you will be pouring out of what you've received. The crushing happens because we are not aligned with the Word, but rather with Jesus. So today, if you've gone through the crushing, go into that vat and say, God, I'm here. Deposit in me. Work in this new self in me, Lord Jesus. Whatever was causing that sinful nature, I'm out of it. Today, allow you to work in and through me. In and through me. And it goes on to say, John 15, when I was reading, it reminded me that Jesus goes on to say, the world hates me. So don't think that the world has to like you. The world will hate you because you are mine. The world will persecute you because it also persecuted me. And one of the things that got me to understand was the fact that Jesus, when He walked here on this earth, went through the crushing Himself. Went through the crushing. So today, a lot of people will preach to you that we are called to be kings, we are called to be sons, we are called to be prosperous. All that may sound good to our itching ears, but when we start going through the gospel narrative of what Jesus has to do in and through our lives, He will crush sin out of us. The more we go deeper in identifying, God, what is it you want me to do? He reveals our sinful nature. He tells us, take your heel and stamp on it. This anger issue which has come down generationally, stamp on it. This alcoholism which has come down generationally, stamp on it. This infidelity which has been coming down to you from generation after generation, stamp on it. It stops with you. Go, let it die with you here in this wine press. And as the wine goes in, allow me to work in you. Let me give you new desires. Let me give you new thirsts. Let me give you new longings. Let me give you new dreams. Let me reveal the will of God for your life so that you can walk in that anointing. So that you can walk in your anointing. So today, as I conclude this point, I want to ask you, what is your VAT today? A lot of you have taken your VAT as your social media. You're thinking you need to process everything out there on social media, but God's saying, no, it's only between you and me. Let us spend time together. A lot of you are finding those who are disgruntled and are thinking, you know what, we need to do this together. No, God's saying, no, I'll deal with them separately. I'm here to deal with you. VAT is where ferments and the sediments go down. Whatever is still lagging behind, he still works and those sediments go down. Learn to enjoy the quietness. Learn to enjoy the presence. Learn to enjoy worshiping. Learn to enjoy reading. Learn to enjoy in meditating. Allow him to speak to you. Those ears, let it start opening up. That is where we learn what we are set apart for and set apart from. We are set apart for his glory and we are set apart from something. And so automatically things start changing. Hebrews chapter 12 verse 11 goes on to say in NLT, no discipline is enjoyable while it's happening. It's painful, but afterward there will be a peaceful harvest of right living for those who are trained in this way. There is going to be a harvest. There is going to be a time of pouring out. There is going to be a time where you will be used. But if you've enjoyed the season of the VAT, where he's caused you to, where he's been in communication, where all those sediments have gone down, he will cause you to live out in the new anointing. The third thing we see is when Jesus is in our lives, we are yielding ourselves to the Holy Spirit daily. We are yielding ourselves to the Holy Spirit daily. Today, now wineskins are filled. Today, I want to ask you, as we read, when the wine is ready, we ask him, God, where do you want me to pour out? And we get transferred from these vats into wineskins. And so it's important that this fresh revelation that we receive does not go back into old bodies, into old wineskins. Because old wineskins won't help you serve its purpose, it'll rather burst. And so this is where we are dependent on the Holy Spirit. When we have new wineskins, where he causes us to pour, we are not called to store up. We are called to pour out. And that's a beautiful thing that we see when with new wine and new wineskins, we are called to pour out. A lot of us have a season of anointing and have carefully been put into our wineskins. But a lot of us are unable to pour out because we still carry that old bitterness, that as a mark that we are still residing in old wineskins. So today, our wineskin don't define us. Don't take an old season's wineskin and try using it in the new season. It won't make sense. Our ministry cannot be what defines us. A lot of us are trying to pour new wine through that lens of ministry. A lot of us are trying to pour out new wine by if we are endorsed by others. No, it's between you and God. Pour it out the way he wants you to pour it out. A lot of us are wanting to be defined and endorsed by others. A lot of us are wanting papas, fathers, bishops, and everyone else breathing through down us to tell where to pour. It's between you and the Holy Spirit. It's between you and the Holy Spirit. All of humanity has only a certain kind and an amount of revelation. No one here has a revelation as much as the Holy Spirit. Depend on the Holy Spirit. Ask him where to pour out. Don't look for significant places. Don't look for significant places. Start doing the insignificant well. Because that's where God wants us to be. That's where God wants us to pour out. Because when we pour out our new wine in insignificant places, he is glorified. Because he brings that significance. To eyes, it still seems insignificant, but to his eyes, everything is significant. Can we imagine that? We will never look for stages and platforms, but rather we would look for God opportunities. We would look for God appointments. We look for God places. So today, when the wine, after it's kept in a vat and fermented, it's meant to be used and poured out. Where is Jesus calling you to pour out today in this kingdom life? You know, when we read about when a wine bottle is open, it has to last for 3 to 6 days. But if you recork it and store it in a cool place and a dark place, it might last. But there are certain things which are present in the wine. They call it the tannins. Tannins are basically plant compounds extracted from grapes during winemaking. They can be found in the skin and the seeds and the stems of the grapes. But if there is more of the tannins, they tend to last longer because they protect it against oxygen. And even as I was reading this, it reminded me the Holy Spirit who breathes life cannot work if there is still tannins in your wine. These sediments are not meant to make it into your wine which is being poured out. So which means it comes down to a daily yielding of the Holy Spirit, because He's going to reveal, hey, this is a tannis, these are sediments, these are things that are not of me, these are things that should have been filtered out. So can you filter it out before you pour it out? That's why every time when we come to serve, we do a filtration and we come. Every time we ask God, God, I feel unworthy to do this, He prepares us and He says, now go do it. You're not doing it out of your strength, you're doing it out of the strength that I give. John 14, verse 26, Jesus says, before He goes, He says, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in My name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. And it got me thinking, a lot of us are unable to listen to the Holy Spirit when He wants to weed out certain things out of our lives. The tannins have to be removed from our lives, from your life and my life. We all have wine to pour, but it comes with these sediments which are not good. And it got me thinking, these tannins, because they don't allow oxygen to happen, it makes the wine last longer. Sometimes you're carrying that extra portion of old wine into a new season. And so today, church, I want us to come to a place. Can we become more aware of what season we are in? Can we be aware of what season we have left, so that we don't yearn for that? If we've left it, we've left it. Let's look at the season we are in. And for those of us who've been in the season that you're in for some time, would you also start looking for the season that you're heading into? Because there are some promises that we start claiming. We need to sometimes have that extra lift in our steps so that we'll be able to push through. We need that extra portion of grace and strength. And so even as I was thinking, God, this kingdom life seems so hard. How do we live it out? What are you wanting us to do? And God reminded me of what I read in 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 7 to 11. And this is what it says. The end of the world is coming soon. Therefore, be earnest and disciplined in your prayers. Most important of all, continue to show deep love for each other, for love covers a multitude of sins. Cheerfully share your home with those who need a meal or a place to stay. God has given each of you a gift from His great variety of spiritual gifts. Use them well to serve one another. Do you have the gift of speaking? Then speak as though God Himself was speaking through you. Do you have the gift of helping others? Do it with all strength and energy that God supplies. Then everything you do will bring glory to God through Jesus. All glory and power to Him forever and ever. Amen. There are a couple of things which I want to highlight even as I close. What does the pouring of wine look like? This anointing that you've received, as each and every one of you have received, it looks different. But here are some applications that we can go back to and think, God, are these some areas that I've intentionally not looked into? Would you allow me to look into? So therefore, the first thing I would say is, therefore, be earnest and disciplined in your prayers. When we receive this anointing, we are disciplined in our prayers. We commit everything to prayer. We don't take anything lightly where we are called to pour out. May we continue to grow in deep love for one another. Cheerfully, without grudgingly and grumbling, share your home with those who need a meal and a place to stay. God has given each and every one of us spiritual gifts. Use them. Serve one another. It says, do you have a gift of speaking? Wait on God and allow Him to open that right door for you to go and speak. Use that gift. Do you have a gift of helping others? Do it with all the strength and energy that God supplies. I remember a friend who was complaining. They had served, they had opened their home and they were having this guest over and they served, and this person enjoyed the meal at their home and they were upset that that person didn't comment anything about the food. Don't do it for the appreciation of people. Do it like you're doing it unto God. If Jesus was sitting at the table, our love should be overrun so much that we'll be able to do it so that we'll come to this place like, God, I'm doing it for you no matter what. And that'll get past. That'll get past. And God's wanting us to rise up to that place that even as we pour out today, even as we are being crushed, even as we are being filled into that vat, even as we are yielding ourselves to the Holy Spirit for our everyday, He's asking to pour out that new wine. To pour out that new wine, would you trust me? Because every place that you go, you would need to do it prayerfully. There's nothing you cannot do without considering it. Pray. And even as I mentioned earlier, may we come to a place where we are able to distinguish between the good and the evil. Because God wants us to be alert. God wants us to be alert. So today, church, even as I close, I want to give this opportunity to you, for those of you who've been struggling to invite Jesus in. Because I know many of us don't love the crushing. Many of us don't love the way in which sometimes God takes us in and molds us and shapes us. But Jesus is saying, if you need to live this kingdom life, you need to go through that. You need to go there. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us be aware, Lord, of the season that we are in so that we'll be useful for you in this kingdom. So church, even as we step in, may every season be a place where we seek for new anointing. May every crushing that we have, may we do it so that our heels are crushing it once and for all, that sin and Satan and his schemes won't have any way. May it be filtered out so that our vats will be filled. May we be fermented so those sediments might go down. Everything of the earthly and sinful nature will die off. And then as we allow the Holy Spirit to live, may we not allow those tannuses to choke hold the Holy Spirit away, but may we rather allow the Holy Spirit to show us where to pour it out. May we not go into preservation mode, but may we go out into pouring out mode so that we are pouring out. Pour my love on you. And I love how God's asking us, would you come out and pour the love that we have for our God towards Him? Towards His people. What God's calling us is not to be in silos, but to do it in community so that we'll be able to see His people and do it for His glory, and so that we'll be able to live this out knowing that God's calling us for greater things in the days to come. So church, can I pray for all those of you listening and watching, if you can join with me. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for this time. Lord, I thank you, Lord, that in the crushing, in the waiting, in the things that are happening right now, Lord, in our own lives, we commit it to you, Lord Jesus. And even as we heard this word, I pray we won't shy away or we won't run away from the kingdom life, but rather we would press on, Lord Jesus. I pray specifically, Lord, for people who are struggling, Lord, of letting go their previous season. I pray, Lord, you would come down right now and give them the strength to let go. I pray for those who are in the season right now and where you've placed them. Let them become more aware, Lord Jesus, more sensitive, more clear of what you're calling them to do, Lord Jesus. I pray for those who are struggling in their faith, Lord Jesus, to take a step of faith into the new season that you're calling. I pray they would step in with new anointing, with a new crushing, Lord Jesus, with new wine, so that in due time they'll be able to pour that out, Lord Jesus. We thank you. Take us on this journey so that we'll be able to give you the glory and honor, that you will be glorified, Lord Jesus. I pray may we never become, Lord Jesus, people who become so sticklers, Lord Jesus, that we just operate out of the physical. And I break everyone who's every spiritual stronghold that's causing us to operate only out of the physical. But I pray there'll be a unison between our spiritual and our physical, that we will operate in that, Lord Jesus. Go before us, be with us. Bless the food and water of our home. Bless our conversations. I pray our doorposts will be marked by your precious blood, that we'll be able to enjoy your love, peace, and joy every day, Lord Jesus. Be with us. I pray especially for those who are listening, Lord Jesus. Holy Spirit, work in them. I pray specifically right now, Lord, people will identify the season that they are in. They will desire for the new wine and they will run after you, Lord. In your most holy name we pray. Amen. Amen. So church, even as you step out this week, I pray you'll step out in boldness. Don't be scared of the word of crushing, because after every crushing comes something beautiful. I am a testament of that. I've seen God come through that. What he's crushed and what he continuously keeps crushing is because this world will cause us to look elsewhere. But that's where we go back to his word. We go back to his presence. We go back to his people. We go back to his church and say, God, I'm here. I've shown up. I'm here for you. Let's press in together. Let's do this kingdom life together, because Jesus wants us to live our best in the kingdom that he's called us to live. So I pray that you have a blessed week. Go out in boldness and be strengthened in Jesus' name. God bless you all. Can I close today's service? May the love of the Father, the grace of his only Son, Jesus Christ, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us now and forevermore. And all God's people said, Amen, Amen. Go in peace and God bless you.
So church, even as we just heard, new wineskins, God is doing something anew, afresh on the earth. And can we just be more aware of it, praying that the Holy Spirit will give you greater discernment of the season you're in, and that the anointing that God gives you for the season will be a fresh one. As you get into this week, remember that whoever finds Jesus finds life. God bless you.